Oh, you're a fool.
Did you like that? Yeah. You could have been halfway across the planet.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Baylor Arts Council is proud to present a concert to think about Jesus, performed by James Farmer. We respectfully request that at this time you silence or put your phones on airplane mode to preserve the ambience of the concert. Thank you very much.
Children he helped to learn to trust.
shouldn't be hard, even though I'm small, to think about Jesus, not hard at all.
Thank you. You guys look great. I can see like the top of your head in the spotlight. So. But welcome everyone. We've got a wonderful set here. We've got brick walls, couch, and my favorite, the door over there. but welcome everyone for coming. Thank you for coming. This concert, the name of the concert actually shares a name with the song I just played, which is To Think About Jesus. So that song comes from the primary children's hymn book, which I just love that book. I think there's so many beautiful, simple little songs that just bring the spirit. And that's kind of my objective tonight, is through music to invite the spirit. And I hope that the spirit can teach you something today. And as many of you know, I just returned from a mission in Eugene, Oregon, for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And it truly was the greatest experience of my life up to this point. The people that I met and the experiences that I had have changed me for good. And I'm grateful for this opportunity to share some of my experiences, some mission stories, and just some of my thoughts and things that are going on in the world right now, and how Jesus can help us through it all. So I said I'd start off with some mission stories. So this one actually, just kind of the circumstance of a lot of my mission was, you know, really different than what I expected because of the COVID-19 pandemic. And that hit about 2 months into my mission. So first 2 months we were knocking doors, riding bikes, and pretty well what I was expecting to be doing as a missionary. But then the pandemic hit and we were locked up in our apartments basically. We could only leave for like 10-minute walks every couple of hours. And we were kind of just left there like, okay, we'll figure out how to be a missionary now that you can't do all these things that you've been doing for the last couple months. And I was fortunate enough to have really awesome companions throughout my entire mission. But at the time when COVID hit, I had two companions, Elder White and Elder Robbins, and we just really kept each other's spirits up. And, you know, in a time when we could have been depressed because we were locked up missionaries in Oregon and, you know, weren't really sure what we were doing, we had fun with it. And I feel really blessed to have had those companions. Even though we didn't know what we were doing, we still felt the spirit. And a lot of that was because of our study time. And we had an increased study time to study the scriptures from what we normally had because there's just more time in the day to fill. And there was a point there where we had about 5 hours throughout the day to study the scriptures. And I really appreciate that time. I'm glad that happened early on in my mission because I learned so much just from reading the scriptures and asking sincere questions in prayer and finding sincere answers. And it was that time where we weren't really interacting with people, especially in person, where I didn't feel alone, but I felt like I was alone with the Savior, if that makes any sense at all. But it was a really tender time, and just grateful for everything that the Spirit taught me during those sacred study sessions. And this next song is by an artist named Supion Stevens. It's kind of a funky name, but he's really great, and he wrote this song called To Be Alone With You, and this song kind of describes, from my perspective, those moments when I was studying, when we were kind of secluded from the rest of the world, and I hope you guys like it. So here's To Be Alone With You by Supion Stevens. Thank you.
Michigan. I'd sell my shoes.
This next song is a song that I wrote on my mission, and it's called Nephi's Lament, because it's based off a chapter in the Book of Mormon, 2 Nephi chapter 4. And this is kind of a famous chapter in the Book of Mormon, just because it is so beautifully and the prophet Nephi kind of starts off this chapter by doing what he always does, just telling about his family, and specifically in this chapter, Lehi is blessing his family and just wishing the best because he would die soon after. And starts off that way, but then it kind of transitions, and Nephi is just kind of talking about why he's keeping this record of spiritual things. And he starts getting really vulnerable, and Nephi starts talking about all of his weaknesses that he feels like he has, and you know, his insecurities, and which is surprising because, you know, this is Nephi, I will go, I will do, and everybody wants to be like Nephi. But in this moment, he, you know, felt a little bit unworthy of, you know, everything that was coming his way. He just felt like he wasn't enough. And I think that's something that a lot of people can relate to, because we're not perfect. So a lot of times, the devil will, you know, let us kind of sulk in those feelings of imperfection, and just kind of let us get down on ourselves. But Nephi doesn't stay in that mindset for very long, and before long, he starts to remember all the things that Jesus has done for him, all the blessings that he's received, and especially for the atonement of Jesus Christ that made it possible for him to overcome his shortcomings. And I thought it was just such a beautiful moment in the scriptures, and so uplifting by the time he finished that chapter, that I wanted to write this song that kind of takes a little bit from the verses and then kind of abridges some of them to fit this song. But I hope you all like Nephi's Lament.
so delighted in the things of love.
I like to get online and look at lots that I could build a future house on and then start designing houses. It gets bad, like I go way far ahead. And sometimes that ends up being frustrating because not every plan goes through exactly the way that I planned it out to be. And that was definitely the case regarding when I would leave on my mission. Before my mission, I always thought that I would graduate high school and then leave the summer right after senior year so that I didn't have to do a little bit of school and then a mission and then back to school. That was my plan. But some of you may have heard this phrase, but when man makes plans, God laughs. And that kind of felt that way because into my senior year a little bit, I had these jaw problems where my jaw would like click and pop. It started to get pretty painful and obnoxious. And we decided to get it checked out, and eventually we had a doctor diagnose it, and basically I would, in order to fix it, need to go through like a retainer that would kind of help fix it. That was gonna take 9 to 12 months for everything to heal. And I was like, wow, okay, well, looks like I'm going to school for a little bit before serving a mission. And, you know, I was a little bit shook up because that wasn't my plan, but it all worked out, and I really enjoyed my semester at Utah State that I had before my mission. I felt like I learned a lot that I wouldn't have otherwise. It was a good preparing experience. But during that semester, you know, my treatment basically finished up, and then the doctor's like, okay, well, now that your jaw's fixed, your mouth moved around, you're gonna need braces too. And I was like super upset by that because braces, like another 2 years, can't go on a mission with braces. And I was just really bummed. And I was like, not really knowing what to do, and kind of threw me in a downward spiral for a little bit where I didn't even know what God wanted from me. You know, I wanted to serve a mission, but I felt like I wasn't able to yet because of these kind of annoying problems, and started to wonder if he really did want me to go on a mission. And I was kind of in this in between, just not sure what to do, state of mind for a month or two, before finally I was in a mission prep class. And in that class, I was just feeling the Spirit really strong and felt like I really needed to just serve a mission, and even if it was gonna take a couple of years waiting to go through braces before going out on my mission, I was gonna do that. And I wrote it down in my study journal and said, nothing will stop me from serving the mission. And I kid you not, this is a miracle, but literally like 30 minutes after that class period ended, I came across some ads for some different dental things, and basically, long story short, I ended up working out that about 9 weeks after I made that decision, I was in the NTC, which was just so many miracles that were involved in that, and things happening when they happened. It all just kind of clicked together, and I don't think it would have worked out that way if I hadn't made that commitment and that promise to the Lord. But I hope that what everyone takes away from this little story, or this experience, is you can have what you want, or you can have something better. You know, and if I would have left when I wanted to leave, I probably would have missed out on a lot of experiences that helped me grow up a little bit and mature and be ready for my mission. I grew a lot on the piano as well because I had professors that I was working with and learned so much that I'm just so grateful that it happened the way it did, even though in the moment it felt like my plans were being ruined. And this next song is another primary children's hymn that I've kind of jazzed up a little bit, and it's called I Will Follow God's Plan. Thank you. Thank you guys. I remember when I was a kid, we would kind of go as a family down to Salt Lake City for various reasons, whether it was a Utah Jazz game, or if we were going to a concert, or just going to Temple Square. We would go down there, and of course, we were walking around Salt Lake City, you see the homeless people. And when I was a kid, I was terrified of the homeless people in Salt Lake City. And I don't know if it was because I had imagined up any like specific thing that they would do to me or harm me, but I think mostly it was just because I felt like I was different from them, and that difference kind of scared me. Fast forward, and open my mission call, Eugene, Oregon. And if you don't know this, Eugene, Oregon has the highest homeless population per capita in the United States. So, get thrown in, my first area, or biking area, and homeless people everywhere, especially on the bike paths in Eugene. And they all kind of camp out underneath these bridges, and it kind of gets a little bit sketchy. lots of good memories underneath those bridges, though. And me and my companion, we would talk to these homeless people a lot, and it didn't take very long before I authentically started to love these people. Even though they probably were like a little bit scary, some of them, we weren't in the right mind, and even though we were really different, I still feel like we made sincere connections with them, and it helped me learn a lot just how God sees all of his children. And I feel like I was really blessed to see some of those people the way that God saw them. Even though they hadn't showered in who knows how long, and you know, they were making pretty poor decisions with their life, and drugs and whatever else they were involved in, I still felt that love for them and that connection. And it got to the point where some of those people, I knew them by name, and be driving in our car like later in my mission, I see kind of one of them, and I was like, oh, that's Kevin. Or that's David Earl Jones. And we were friends and had lots of good talks with them, and I don't know how much they really ever got out of our conversations. A lot of people in Eugene like to talk about religion, and they like to study religion, but a lot of them don't really have like set beliefs with themselves. They're just interested in what other people believe. But I still feel like some of those conversations were uplifting, and I hope that they get to a point in their life where, you know, they a little bit more in the right mind, and they can remember some of the light that they felt when they were talking to us or to any other missionaries or member of the church that they've met throughout their life. But I think this story is just one example of, you know, I saw something in myself that, you know, I kind of wanted to be better at, about, you know, not judging people just by the way that they looked, or giving them a chance, and just authentically showing them the love of Christ. And one of my very favorite songs is I'm Trying to Be Like Jesus, which is exactly what I've been talking about, and I'd like to play that for you right now. Thank you.
But the Holy Spirit enters into my thoughts, saying, love one another as Jesus loves you. Each other so kindness in all that you do. Be gentle and loving in deed and in thought. For these are the things Jesus
song is a song I wrote a long time ago. It's on my first album, which I have albums just outside the door for when the concert's over. My first album, that song is called A Reason to Stand, and it just kind of is about the moments where, you know, you're broken down to, you know, your very basic form. You have to find a reason to stand through it all. And I found in my life that reason to stand is found in the rock of my Savior Jesus Christ. And we are welcoming in an exciting time of year where we have the Christmas season and everyone's focus comes a little bit more on the Savior, the birth of the Savior, and also the life of the Savior, and his perfect example and all the things that he did for us. And there's all sorts of Christmas traditions that I've enjoyed over the years. One of them is watching home videos with my siblings. And we have a lot of fun with that. We kind of make fun of each other, like, oh, like, you were so silly when you were little. And it's just a good time. Speaking of silly siblings, I'm going to have two of them come up, Jalen and Lexi. So girls are going to start making way up here. They're going to sing this next song with me. And this song actually has to do with Christmas tradition as well. In high school, I was part of the high school show choir. Loved it, had all sorts of fun. And every Christmas, when Christmas time would come around, we would sing the same song. And we would invite like the veterans from the show choir, like people that have been in it before but graduated. We would invite them to come up and sing with us. And just this really fun tradition that we had. And the song is called Shine For Me Again, Star of Bethlehem. And then I found out on my mission that the lady that wrote the lyrics for this song, her name is Sherry Bird, she lived within my mission boundaries. And so a couple of my friends, one of them would eventually be my companion, but they're here today, but they filmed Sherry Bird's testimony, and she talked about this song and kind of her inspiration behind it, where you know, she was kind of just thinking, well, what do we think about our Christmas time? When we think of the star, what if one of the shepherd boys that was following the star at times, like maybe it was blocked by a cloud, maybe it was blocked by a tree or something. He couldn't always see it, but he'd keep moving in that direction. She kind of weaves this story into, you know, later on this shepherd boy maybe has some doubts about what he really saw, and if his star was still there. And if you really did have that experience where he saw the Savior as a baby. And it's just a very interesting perspective, I think, to write a Christmas song about. I think it's a beautiful song. My sisters have beautiful voices, and they're going to come sing up with me. So here's Shine For Me Again, Star of Bethlehem. absolutely wonderful. No, Lexi's not old enough today. Jocelyn is 16, but she wanted me to let you all know that she's not looking for a boyfriend. Now they're embarrassed. This next song, I think everyone knows it. It's Hallelujah by Leonard Cohen. Some people know it by the Shrek song. Except for the words have changed a little bit. These are the Christmas lyrics. So even more focused on the Savior and on this special time of year. But the chorus is the same. It's Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. You are more than welcome to join on any of the courses that you want to, but especially the last ones. So I really love your participation in singing this song with me. And here it is, Alleluia.
Hallelujah. Alleluia. 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 Alleluia.
One last time.
Alleluia. 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 Alleluia.
Thank you guys. You sound beautiful. Thank you. All right, we're gonna have another sibling step up here, Keaton Farmer. Brother. Song we're gonna play is by one of the Beatles, George Harrison, guitar wizard himself. And this is interesting, this was from the first album that he released after the Beatles, so his first solo album. The song we're gonna play is called My Sweet Lord. George Harrison was actually, a lot of times he was referred to as the spiritual Beatle. Because he, you know, kind of searched for that connection with God. He was, of course, raised in England, and so he kind of grew up with Christian beliefs and kind of was just around that. Later on in his lifetime, he started exploring kind of elsewhere, looking for God. And he kind of settled a little bit with some of the Eastern religions like Buddhism and Hinduism. Which I think is interesting, and that's kind of how a lot of the people in Eugene are. They know a lot about Christianity, and they love a lot about Christianity and believe it. But they also like, you know, other in the Eastern religions. It's just interesting to them. And it was kind of interesting because we were teaching some people that were like that, and we would say, like, open with questions just to get them talk a little bit and say, well, who is God to you? And they would start off by saying, well, the Hindus believe, yada, 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 but the Baptists believe this, but this other church, they knew a lot about different religions, but they didn't really have, like, any internal beliefs. When we asked them what they believed, they didn't know. And I feel like that was kind of George Harrison's situation, but, you know, between all that, he still knew that there was a God and was just searching for him. And this song, My Sweet Lord, is obviously like connected to his like Christian roots. And you know, he would go on to say that he really did love a lot about Christianity, about what Jesus Christ taught, the example that he was. And this song is just happy. I think it's a vibe. It's very fun to listen to when George Harrison plays it. We're gonna try to recreate that here today. And just praising the Lord Jesus Christ, my sweet Lord. Thank you. take a bow to you. He's so cool. Theophilus. And if any of you are wondering, what the heck is a Theophilus, I'm about to tell you. So, in the scriptures, at the beginning of the Gospel of Luke, and also at the beginning of the Acts, so both of these are in the New Testament, both of these books are expected to be written by Luke, and they're written to a guy named Theophilus. So, right in like the first verses of these books, he says like, my beloved Theophilus, and then kind of goes on, like, I'm gonna tell you these experiences that I know about the Savior Jesus Christ, and explains. And that's how the Gospel of Luke starts. And it's interesting though, because Theophilus is a Greek word, Greek name, and literally translates to lover of God, because Theo means God, and Phil means love. So, lover of God, this is Theophilus. So, there might have been a person named Theophilus that Luke was writing to, which is like super cool. But he also could have just been addressing like anybody that loves God when he was writing this. But anyways, I thought that was just really cool when I learned that. And I was thinking like, well, what if Luke and Theophilus were like pretty good buddies, and Theophilus being a lover of God, maybe he was a really good influence on Luke. And I kind of ran with this idea and was like, oh yeah, this needs to be a song. So, this actually captures something that I'm really grateful for. I've had so many good friends throughout my life. A lot of them are here today, which thank you all for coming. And, you know, whether we were friends from my days pre-mission in Bear Lake, or I met you on my mission or somewhere else, I'm just really grateful for all of my friends. And especially, I feel like a lot of my friends have been really good influences on me and good examples of disciples of Jesus Christ. I'd say that especially with the friends that I made on my mission that I served around, the fellow missionaries. And we were just all really close, and we still are. And I'm convinced that a lot of that is because we served together. You know, unity or like friendship doesn't come from just hanging out, but you know, we have a really special bond because we were doing the work of the Lord together. And I'm really grateful for that, and for all of you that have been in my life, just really great examples. So this song is written to a Theophilus, or like my own Theophilus, Theophili, is that a plural for Theophilus? I don't know. This is just about all the wonderful friends that I've had throughout my life. So here's Theophilus. Theophilus, lover of God, and your Baptist friend. Your love of God stretches to the end of the earth. I reminisce, running the halls like we were just kids. Who would have thought it would come to this? Now we're here. You follow where he leads you. I wanna be there to see how you give. As long as you live, though, you're never gonna see me the way you helped me be all into the end. And all 'cause you're my friend, Theophilus. You're helping me see what he's done for me. See how we lived so selflessly. How could it be that you follow where he leads you? I wanna be there to see how you give. Be all into the end, and all 'cause you're my friend, Theophilus.
Theophilus. Theophilus.
So, I feel like because I've had so many good friends throughout my life, sometimes you have to say goodbye to your friends, and moments where I've had to say goodbye are just really, really sad for me. I just kind of want everybody to stay together and just kind of be a whole gang and just kind of still have that same bond. But truth is, life happens, and sometimes life takes you in different directions, and you kind of have to go somewhere else and make new friends and make new connections, and then you'll probably have to say goodbye in some sense. I had a companion, his name was Father Robbins, and one thing he would always say when people would get transferred, or even if he was gonna see you tomorrow or in like 5 years, he'd say the same thing. He'd say, it's not a goodbye, it's just a see you later. And I love that because, I don't know, that just makes me feel a lot better. It's like, oh yeah, just a see you later instead of just goodbye. That's so depressing. But about my like freshman sophomore year in high school, I had to say goodbye to a lot of people that I just loved and cared about and just loved being around. Seniors that graduated and left to college and missions, I had to say goodbye to them. Band teachers that I was really close to. All these goodbyes just kind of had me sad. But in school, we were assigned to read A Tale of Two Cities by Charles Dickens. And I definitely would have never read that book by myself, but thank you for the assignment, teacher, because we got a song title out of it. And in one of the chapters in this book, the chapter is called Echoing Footsteps. And these people are kind of in this house that is in this kind of stone courtyard, and it's raining. And basically because of the way the courtyard was and the rain and everything, they could hear really vividly all these footsteps from people that were walking in and out of the courtyard. They would fade in, they'd be really strong, they would fade out. They kind of just had this conversation and started wondering, like, well, what could this mean? And they were looking for a deeper meaning, and the meaning that they kind of decided on was how people walk in and out of your life all the time, but that doesn't change the effect that they have on your life when they are there constantly. And that kind of helped me just have like a better mindset, like people do walk in and out of your life, but you can never replace the effect that they had on you. And so this song is named after that chapter in Tale of Two Cities. It's called Echoing Footsteps. And this is the title track, actually, for my second album. I released it like right before I left on my mission. And we've got that outside. CDs, if you're interested or if you want one like for a friend since it's Christmas, my CDs are $10 for a CD, or you can get both of them for $15. So there's my plug, but here's Echoing Footsteps, and I hope you all enjoy it. Thank you. actually also kind of shares some references to A Tale of Two Cities, because this song is called A Tale of Two Josephs. So the two Josephs I'm talking about in this song that I wrote like pretty early on in my mission, Joseph of Egypt and Joseph Smith. And we know from the Book of Mormon that Joseph of Egypt actually prophesied about Joseph Smith that he'd be the son of someone that shared his name, Joseph Smith Sr. And I think there's a lot of parallels and connections between these two prophets that shared a name. And they both had very difficult lives, but they both really were instrumental in the gathering or saving of Israel. And I just thought it was a cool connection, so I decided to write a song about it. And this is gonna be the last song of tonight. And so I have some thank yous that I need to get out there. First off, a thank you to the Bear Lake Arts Council for, you know, working your magic and sponsoring and kind of promoting tonight and getting the word out. We also have Randy and Kyle, my friends up in the booth running sound and lights. So thank you guys so much for making this possible. And also, of course, my parents for funding my piano lessons and various musical interests, and for just being so supportive. And I'd also like to thank Mark Alpers. Mark was a member in my first ward that I served in on my mission, and I was lucky enough to serve in his ward twice because he and his family moved, and then I followed them like a month later. It was really cool. So first like 10 months of my mission were spent with Alpers, but early on in my mission, you know, I made a sacrifice that like I would, you know, put away things that I really cared about. And one of them was music. You know, obviously like not listening to music that I would listen to before, and definitely not having nearly enough time to practice on the mission. Just too many important things to do. And it was to the point where I kind of went a little bit too far with that, and I almost never played the piano or used the gifts or talents that I'd been given. I was kind of burying them. And Mark found out that I played the piano and that I wrote music when I gave him a couple of my CDs that I gave to people throughout my mission that I was really close with. And he called me one day and he's like, "Are you writing music on your mission?" And I was like, "No, like I gave that up for 2 years, so I'm just kind of leaving it alone." And he kind of reamed me for that. He got after me and he was like, "Well, like David Archuleta wrote music on his mission," and he's like, why would you do that?" And I was like, "Oh, yeah, I should probably put at least a little bit of effort." And so because of that conversation, I started writing this song. This is the first song I wrote while I was on my mission, and kind of progressed from there until it got to a point where I was like, "Oh, wait, I have enough of these, I could do a concert," and here we are. So thank you to all these wonderful people, Bear Lake Arts Council, Randy, Kyle, parents, Mark, and of course, Kim Hume, who taught me how to play the piano. She's my piano teacher, and I just love her so much. So can everyone just put your hands together for these people? So here's A Tale of Two Josephs.
Joseph was a dreamer. His brothers flitted fear, a ruler over Israel. He would become soul and soul, their father's son. And in Egypt land, there was nowhere he could run. For Potiphar, those who came to Joseph's door would stand. And I wonder how he felt that day when Judah and Dan, his brothers knelt before him in the sand. And Joseph, by the Lord, was led to save their lives that they'd be fed. He revealed himself, his brothers wept, and his father fell upon his neck. His sacrifice, a type of Christ, his coat, his power in all his life. Joseph gave it all to serve God well, to save the sons of Israel.
Thank you.